are such a genuine gem. Thank you for clicking on my video. I'm Brooke McKenna, but today's case is about Juan Catalan, how a TV show proved that he was wrongfully convicted. Now, this case is a whirlwind of deception and false information. Two victims thought to be connected in the strangest of ways, a confession that went unheard for years, and a man who was almost given the death penalty. Listen closely to this one. You don't want to miss a thing. It was 2003 in California, and a girl named Martha Puebla lived in Sun Valley, Los Angeles. She actually lived on the corner of Lowell Street and Case Avenue, and she was just 16 years old. She unfortunately had not grown up in the nicest crowd of people, and as she grew up, she kind of had to figure out the ins and outs of keeping herself out of danger around them. However, on May 12th, even with all of her best efforts, she couldn't be kept alive. At 10:43 p.m., the police would be called to her home, and her mother would be outside distraught at this point. As the police rushed around the block trying to cordon off the area, she said that she hadn't seen a thing. She only had heard the gunshots and ran outside. Neighbors said they heard the same exact thing. They heard gunshots and they heard Martha's mother screaming, and she actually spoke Spanish, so I'm probably going to butcher this, but she screamed, "Dios mío, esto muerte," or "My God, she's dead." Now, they also claimed, the neighbors did, that they saw a Chevy Malibu driving around the neighborhood around the time of the murder. Nobody had seen it before. The 16-year-old girl with her life ahead of her was now lying on her back on the curb with her legs out in front of her, and she had a gunshot wound to her left cheek and her eyes were still open. She had also been wearing a white sweater that was now stained a deep shade of red. Upon further inspection on this autopsy, it was found that Martha had been shot in quite a close range, and it left soot and burn marks on her cheek. But the wound was actually just below her left eye and not actually on her cheek. But the murder weapon was thought to be a 9mm handgun. Next to her body was a clue. It was actually a phone that appeared to have been thrown down. This was traced back to a person known to be Martha's friend. Martha's friend was then talked to about why in the world Martha was now deceased on the curb and why they fled from the crime scene. They claimed that they were outside talking to Martha when they heard a man walk up behind them, and this man had asked Martha who she was. And Martha allegedly responded very confused, saying, "I'm Martha, you know me." However, just at that moment, this man pulled a gun out of his shirt pocket and shot her. At this point, Martha's friend ran in a panic, dropping their phone, and this killer sped away. This is when a sketch artist was brought in for this witness to be able to identify Martha's killer. However, investigators knew even before seeing this sketch what had happened, or they believed they knew what had happened. You see, they knew this victim. They knew Martha, but not because she had a criminal record or was often in trouble with police, but because a few months prior, they had been called to her house. This was November 27th, 5 months prior to Martha's murder, and a little before 2 a.m., Martha had heard a knock on her window. When Martha went to see who it was her friend asking her if she wanted to come out with her and a boy named Christian, who was still in the car. Now, as Martha started thinking about whether she wanted to go in the middle of the night, the unthinkable happened. Without warning, Martha's friend jumped through the window and kind of came at her, but this was because Martha's friend had heard gunshots ringing out, and in a fight or flight response, she had chosen flight and gotten through this window to safety. However, when the girls realized that the shooting had stopped, they slowly crept back out of the window to go see what had happened. And that's when they went up to Christian, who was in this car waiting for them, and realized he was the one who had been shot. Now, he was actually still alive, and he would ask them for help, but before they could get him any, he passed away. Someone had murdered him in Martha's driveway just 5 months before she was murdered there as well. So did investigators believe that the same person had murdered them? Well, not exactly. You see, they had a different explanation for Martha's murder. When investigating Christian's murder, they had a suspect pretty quickly in that case because they had been looking into a gang in the area called the Vineland Boys, and this was named after Vineland Street in North Hollywood, or Vinland Street. I'm not exactly sure how to say it, but this gang had actually evolved in the 1980s from the infamous 18th Street Gang, and this was the largest criminal gang in Los Angeles history, with about 30,000 to 50,000 members. They were spread all through 20 different states. They were also thought to recruit kids as young as elementary school, and in fact, the United States Department of Justice said that the 18th Street Gang was responsible for giving the Central American Northern Triangle the highest homicide rate in the world. Gang members were to obey the leader at all costs, or they could be killed themselves. Of course, this gang is thought to be responsible for robberies, murders, extortion, human trafficking, and much more. This was thought to be the same with the Vinland Boys, and investigators knew about this gang and had been looking into them for years, especially for drug sales in the area. The problem was, it was very hard to catch these gang members and to prove they were involved. Then, after talking to multiple people in the area, there was one man who kept coming up as someone that everybody suspected. And this was 19-year-old Jose Ledesma, and he was actually thought to be a member of this gang as well as the shooter of Christian. So given the opportunity to get a warrant to search Jose's home, they immediately did so, in fact, that same night. And what they found didn't surprise them in the slightest. Under Jose's mattress was actually a loaded assault rifle and letters from other Vinland Street gang members. These were from other members who were in prison at the time, and they all called Jose Peps. They all had little code names to keep them from being caught. However, although they had this evidence against him, Jose was not home and they could not question him. They feared that he would soon be on the run. 2 days later, investigators got a call to their police department in California from the police department in Mexico. The police there said that they had two men who they were told were wanted for murders in Los Angeles. These two men were brought back to LA and they were beginning to be questioned when investigators realized that this was Jose Ledesma and another gang member named Mario Catalan. Now, they had crossed the border to check into a motel in Mexico, only to get the police called on them there. And this was because Mario's girlfriend, who he had been drinking with all day long, got into a fight that was so bad that a stranger walking by called the police on domestic violence. Now, their main suspect in Christian's murder was in custody, but Jose was telling him they had the wrong person. But that is when investigators found a handgun in the location that these two men were staying in Mexico, and they sent it to be tested to see if this could be Christian's murder weapon. However, no matter how long they interrogated Jose, he was not budging. He did not tell them anything. Until, that is, they put Jose and Mario in a cell together after telling them both that the handgun had been found and further spooking them. What they didn't know was that there was a hidden microphone in this cell with them, recording everything they said. And immediately Mario began to talk about this handgun that had been found and that he was freaking out about it. But Jose and Mario would be taken to trial. And guess who would testify against them? That's right, Martha Puebla. She was on the stand in front of them, and then she was asked to point out who was the shooter of Christian Vargas. At this point, this would give Jose and Mario motive to kill her for speaking up. The problem was she didn't speak up. In fact, she didn't point out the killer. She simply sat there and said she didn't see them well enough to be sure. So why kill a girl who didn't snitch? Well, that's because she actually did, or that's what investigators said. You see, she had been asked by investigators to look at a photo lineup of six individuals, and Martha had circled Jose's picture, as well as writing underneath it, "This is the guy that shot my friend's boyfriend," and then she signed it. But how could Mario and Jose have known this if she had just talked to investigators and didn't say anything at trial in front of them? Well, that's because the detectives working on the case, named Pinner and Rodriguez, had done everything possible to get a confession out of Jose. And that included showing them Martha's statement and exactly what she said. Jose had said that he didn't know Martha, and they told him that Martha knew him. That's when they showed him her picture. So this gave a perfect motive, until you realize that the handgun found at the residence Mario and Jose were staying at did match Christian's murder, as well as another murder that happened that week as well. And so, while awaiting trial, they would be staying in prison, and that's exactly where they would be 5 months later when Martha was murdered. Investigators knew that this could mean another gang member was responsible for Martha's murder, but they actually had a suspect in mind because they started looking into who was in the courtroom that day when Martha testified, and they found that Mario Catalan had a younger brother. And he was in attendance, and he also looked like the sketch that Martha's friend who had dropped their phone and fled after seeing who killed Martha had made. Exactly 3 months after Martha's murder, Juan Catalan drove up to work, and he would be arrested. He was immediately surrounded as soon as he got out of his car, and he looked at his father, who had opened the door, and asked him what was going on. This was August 12th when he was taken in to be questioned. Immediately, he was told that he was being identified as a killer, and that he matched a sketch of this killer that showed that he was a Hispanic male with black hair from 5'7 to 5'11, 19 to 25 years old, a stocky build, a medium mustache, and this was just like him. They believed he had done this for his brother, and they also had a tip that he had dropped off his cousin at his home around 100 yards from the murder that night. Juan said he didn't know what was going on, he was speechless, and his girlfriend was told at the time that he was being arrested for murder, and she said that he would not hurt anyone. He told detectives that they were using very strong words telling him that he killed someone and that they were going to be very sorry for doing this. Detectives then charged him with the murder of Martha Puebla, and they were quickly talking about giving him the death penalty. Juan was very honest about his brother and what he had done as a child. In fact, Juan said he looked up to his brother Mario, and because he was his big brother. And as they, you know, got older, Mario got into some bad things and was always coming home with stolen goods. And when Juan got old enough, he actually started to join them, and he was the driver. And at this point, he would get arrested, and he said after that he never wanted to be arrested again. He said he really tried to live a good and normal life. He also said that the day of the murder, he finally remembered, after being questioned for so long and not having any idea, trying to think back to what he was doing that exact day that was, you know, 3 months prior, he finally realized that he was somewhere. He was at the Los Angeles Dodgers baseball game with his six-year-old daughter and two friends. He had bought the tickets for his mother from someone who had a season pass, but he ultimately hoped that his mother would just give it to him, which she did. And Juan decided to bring some friends and his daughter because he loved baseball. He could remember every little play that happened, and he was obsessed with it since he was a little kid. So he said they all went to this arena and they sat and they watched the game. He said afterwards he called his girlfriend before heading home and then begged her to come over so that they could be together, and she said that she was tired, but he was very persuasive, and so she did go over there. That night, Juan said he had a dream that was quite strange about aliens taking him away, and the next day he pulled up into his family's shop and was taken away. But not by aliens, by police. He would then be put into a cage on the prison bus before being transported to a maximum security prison. A man named Todd Melnick became Juan's lawyer, and he listened to everything Juan was saying and really believed that he was innocent. So he wanted to get these Dodger tickets as a start to finding that he was innocent. So he asked Alma, which was Juan's girlfriend, if she could look for the tickets, and she tore apart her entire house before finally finding them and handing them over. Todd then went to the executive vice president of the Dodgers at the time, which was Sam Fernandez, and asked if he could get some information, basically, of the people who were sitting around them at the time of this certain game. Now, unfortunately, they were all season ticket holders, but none of them said that they saw Juan well enough to be able to testify for him. The next step was to look at footage of this game to see if by any chance they could see Juan in the crowd. Now, Todd took this home with him and watched every single second on slow-mo, so a 3-hour game took like all day for him to get through. That's when he noticed a man who looked a lot like Juan in this certain area. He slowed the footage, he played it again, and Todd was certain that it was him. The problem was, it was far too grainy to be able to be certain that it was, and it especially would not work in court. Feeling defeated, Todd talked to Juan again about the game, about anything that he could remember, and that's when he said he believed that someone was filming something there. He said that on the day that he went, it was very different than all the other games that he had been to because there was a lot more security in this certain area. And there was a man who kept walking up and down the aisles like he was doing the same thing over and over again, like perhaps he was doing different takes. Todd knew that this could be what he needed to get Juan to be proven innocent. This meant that there was more footage out there that could show Juan. Thankfully, Dodgers Stadium had kept a record of everybody who would film there and use the arena for projects like this, and Todd got a number that he could call. What he didn't expect was for HBO to answer the phone. He started talking to them about what they had been doing and that they were trying to get Juan off of this death penalty and that he had been wrongfully arrested, and that is when he was told a tidbit of information. He was told that someone was filming there, and they were filming at section 327, which was Juan's exact section. However, they weren't going to show him any of this footage because they never did it before it aired. They never showed anyone anything before it was out on TV. They then said that they were filming for a show called Curb Your Enthusiasm with a man named Larry David, who was the creator of Seinfeld. Tom heard this and begged anyone and everyone to let him see this footage because if he waited, it could be far too late for Juan. That's when they started playing season 4, episode 7 of Curb Your Enthusiasm, which was called The Carpool Lane. Now, this is where Larry was going to be headed home from work when he realized that there was a ton of traffic and the only lane moving was the carpool lane. So he picked up a sex worker to go with him to be able to use that lane. However, he ended up taking her to a Dodgers game. The story at the game was that Larry was up in these really bad seats and then he saw a friend who was in better seats. So he went down there to talk to him. To get down there, he had to go down these sets of stairs. And so, hearing this, Todd thought maybe this is where Juan saw this man going up and down and up and down trying to get these takes. But tape after tape was shown to Todd and he was seeing no sign of Juan, and that's when he was told that if anybody got up out of their seats at all, they kind of tried to hold them back from going and sitting back down so they could get this shot clear and easily. And Todd remembered that Juan said his daughter wanted to go get some candy and he had taken her throughout this game. However, just as Larry was walking back up these stairs, there was a father and daughter who entered the shot. You could see them from behind, and immediately Todd jumped out of his chair and screamed in disbelief that that was him. They had a full view of Juan and his daughter walking down those stairs and going into their seats. It was some sort of miracle that they had been captured when nobody else was allowed in. And when talking to Juan, he had said that he was held back like everybody else. But at one point, one crew member just looked at him and said, "Yeah, you guys can go ahead." They were the only ones allowed. The problem was, this only showed that Juan was there until 9:15 because that's when the filming ended. meaning that based on evidence, he was still able, or he still would have been able to leave and commit the murder at 10:43 p.m. Juan said that he stayed the whole game. He didn't leave early. He was there past 10 p.m. and he claimed to buy some baseball cards for his daughter well after that at a certain stand. But he hadn't used a credit card, he used cash, so there was no way to trace that. Some people believed that Juan was innocent, and others really believed he had murdered Martha. That he had done this to get revenge for his brother. Juan had always said that he was innocent, and so Todd's next plan of action was involving phone records. You see, Juan had said that he called his girlfriend Alma right before they left the Dodger Stadium. He said that this was about 10:12 p.m. Looking at the records, Todd then found something that put everything together. And everybody finally knew whether he was innocent or guilty. At 10:12, Juan's phone pinged right across the street from the Dodgers Stadium at a cell tower. This meant that if he had made that phone call from Dodgers Stadium, he couldn't have made it back to Martha's home in time to kill her. Juan hadn't left early, but was this enough to prove that he really didn't kill her? That he didn't have somebody else call from his phone? And an even more important question, who was the killer of Martha if it wasn't Juan? We'll get to that in a little bit. Because in total, Juan had been in prison for 6 months before his trial. And during this preliminary hearing, all of the evidence was presented, and Juan's little daughter even had to testify for him, saying that she was with her daddy at the Dodger Stadium and that he bought her candy and cards. And the prosecutor against him was actually known to be the sniper because she had never lost a death penalty case. However, it was the judge's decision, and at the end of this hearing, Todd leaned over to Juan and said that it was over. The judge then decided to dismiss the entire case. Juan was free and cleared of murder. He had been wrongfully accused. He was reunited with his family, and when they told him that they would give him whatever he wanted, all he said he wanted was a Coke. He just missed it because they didn't get any in prison. And as amazing as it was for a wrongfully convicted man to now be freed, that meant that Martha's killer was free as well. No one knew who had done this to her. However, 3 years later, in 2018, the FBI had gotten involved because they had found some interesting information involving the police department. They had found that Martha had been used as a way to get a confession out of another killer. You remember Christian Vargas? Well, although it was told to pretty much everyone that Martha was the one who snitched and told on Jose Ledesma for being Christian's murderer, she in fact had not done this. She didn't snitch. She said she didn't know who did it. She didn't name anybody. And in fact, she told her friend, she threatened her friend that if she snitched, she would have to tell the gang where her family lived. She was dead set on not getting involved in this case. And that's exactly the opposite of what they did to her. Because Jose Ledesma was told during his interrogation that she was the reason he was in jail. And in fact, it was found that the night after Jose was told this, he called a man named Cokester. And he said, "Do you know that slut that lives there by my house? Her name starts with an M. I need her to disappear. She's dropping dimes." And if you remember, there was a microphone in his jail cell, and this phone that he called this man on was really close to it, so it picked up this call and this possible confession. However, apparently the microphone had only picked up things that were transcribed by an outside company, and it was badly transcribed, so nobody really knew what it said. And so nobody had really listened to it until January of 2005. That was because Christian's murder trial was coming up and they knew they would have to listen to it in court. So they started listening to it again, and that's when they found Jose talking about killing a girl with the first initial M. FBI found that Cokester was actually another gang member called Javier Carubas, and from there it was found that Javier took a man named Raul Robledo to Martha's home. And Jose, of course, was already in jail for Christian's murder, but then Javier and Raul were arrested. And all three of them were sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole. There's also said to be a fourth member they thought to be involved who fled to Mexico. I couldn't find on whether this person has ever been arrested or caught, but it is said to be four in total who were involved. Martha's parents then filed a civil lawsuit against the detectives on her case, saying that they used her to get a confession but didn't provide any sort of protection for her, didn't even inform her that she was being outed as this witness when she didn't do anything that they said she did. She didn't tell them anything. She refused to. And yet she wasn't given the chance to be put into the witness protection program. Now, Detective Juan Rodriguez was transferred to the auto theft unit, and Detective Martin Penner was no longer allowed to be on homicide cases. I couldn't find exactly what he's doing at this point, but both were also interviewed, and there was a lengthy investigation into their investigative skills, and they both confessed to trying to trick Juan into a confession. Because, of course, he wasn't guilty. Juan sued the LAPD and got $320,000, and he has said, "My life has changed immensely and for the better. The experience I've had, the people I've met, the places I've gone, it's actually all come from this, which is something crazy to think about. It was such a bad experience, and to have all of this good come out, I just feel blessed." And he now actually has a documentary on Netflix called Long Shot, and I really recommend it. Now, not only was Juan put through so much as an innocent man, but Martha was also killed for a false statement by detectives who gave her zero protection. As bad as it is to have this stigma that, you know, of no snitching or you'll get killed yourself, detectives who knew this gang and knew this area most likely knew exactly what they were doing and what they were putting her in danger of when they outed her as a witness. They knew exactly what they were doing, they knew who they were messing with, and they didn't even tell her, probably because they didn't want her to be upset and they didn't want to have to deal with it. So I do think that we have three victims in this case: Christian, Martha, and Juan. And thankfully, Juan did survive. He did get out. He does get to live with his family, but it will never be the same. His family was put through so much trauma. He was as well. And all just because they didn't listen to the recording that they had placed in the cell, which I just don't understand why they wouldn't listen to it, but I'd love to hear your thoughts and opinions on this, and don't ever forget to speak up. Your voice is powerful enough, and I love you to absolute pieces. Okay. Bye.